faith we see the hand of God in the light of creation's grand design, in the lives of those who prove his faithfulness, who walk by faith and not by sight. By faith our fathers roamed the earth with the power of his promise in their hearts, of a holy city built by God's own hand, a place where peace and justice reign. We will stand as children of the promise. We will fix our eyes on him, our soul's reward, till the race is finished and the work is done. We'll walk by faith and not by sight. By faith the prophets draw the end. When the longed-for Messiah would appear, with the power to break the chains of sin and death, and rise triumphant from the grave. By faith the church was called to grow, in the power of the Spirit to the lost, to deliver captives and to preach good news in every corner of the earth. We will stand as children of the promise. We will fix our eyes on him, our soul's reward, till the race is finished and the work is done. We'll walk by faith and by sight. By faith this mountain shall be moved, and the power of the gospel shall prevail. For we know in Christ all things are possible.
Song referred to many who have gone before us in this faith journey, as does the scripture we're reading this morning from Hebrews.
Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart.
From 1 Corinthians, therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain.
We have a choice, brothers and sisters. Things will be hard at times. I mean, they were for Jesus. But is it worth it to persevere, you know, to finish the race? Absolutely. I felt this next song might encourage some of us in that journey, in a hard time maybe. we can choose to praise Him.
Count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy in all my days. Oh, yes, I will. Count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. And yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy in all my days. Oh, yes, I will for all my days. Oh, yes, I will. I choose to pray. Nothing can stand against, and I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. And nothing can stand against, and I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. Then nothing can stand against, and I choose to praise. Glorify, glorify the name of all names. Then nothing can stand against. And yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. And yes, I will bless your name.
So we could do that is because He is with us. He is faithful.
Standing on this mountaintop, looking just how far we've come, knowing that for every step You were with us. Kneeling on this battleground, seeing just how much You've done, knowing every victory is Your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say. Faithful.
just how much you've done, knowing every victory was your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, never once did we ever walk alone. Never once, no, we never walk alone. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. Every step we are breathing,
we do thank you for your faithfulness. Father, we thank you that you walk with us and carry us if we need it. We thank you, Father, that you have indeed never left us, and you won't. And you give us those victories in our past to think on in the future when we'll need them again. We'll know of your faithfulness and rely on that. Lord, we thank you in advance for the service that you will provide, for the words that you will.
Good to come together, to worship together. So thank you for being here. If you are new, or if you're just visiting our church, my name is Doug Batts. I'm the children and youth pastor here, and just want to extend a warm welcome to you this morning. Thank you for being here. If you are new, or if you'd like to learn more about our church or who we are, what's going on, would encourage you to pick up and read a bulletin. There's lots of information. There's lots of things that are going on. And on the back page of the bulletin, there's a little response card that you can fill out if you have questions, if you'd like to learn more, whatever it may be. You can just fill that out. On the back side of that is a prayer card, that if you have anything that you would like for us as a church to be praying with you about, would encourage you to just fill that out as well. Then you can just tear that off of your bulletin and drop it in one of the two boxes located by the doors as you come into the sanctuary. We would love to hear from you. We'd love to be praying with you. For whatever it may be. If you have questions, I would encourage you to just stop by the Welcome Center and visit with the folks there. They can help answer those questions or point you in the right direction, especially for those of you that are online. You can go visit our website, beloitfcc.org, and find out more about who we are and what's going on in the church there. And then at the end of the service, Pastor Cliff, Pastor Dave, and myself, we will be available at the doors to visit with you if you have questions. If you have anything that you would like to pray about, I would encourage you, just during the closing song, to come out, and we would love to pray with you at that time. So a few things that I want to cover on the bulletin, and actually a lot of other people want to cover as well. So first off, I'm going to have Tom Maxwell come up and share some things with you.
What I have is a public service announcement. The Boyd Senior Center we're down to the senior center manager as far as working people is concerned there. We need to hire at least one more person. The hours would be, you know, you come in 9 or 9:30 and you're done 12:30 or 1 o'clock, so there's not great hours, but it's Monday through Friday. And it pays $8 an hour, so if you're looking to earn a little extra pocket change, there you go. It's not real hard. You'd be packing meals. Debbie would be putting them in the trays and closing them, and you just putting them in the sack and put a name on them for the for those of us who take them to the shut-ins. You might you be doing dishes, little light housekeeping like vacuuming, wiping off surfaces, and that sort of stuff. If you're interested, you can contact me, or you can contact Debbie Raymer at the Senior Center. Thank you.
Thanks, Tom. Next up, Kent Miller would like to share a little on Clash.
For the past several weeks and even months, you've been hearing Doug say that we need help with Clash. Well, he wasn't lying. We do need a few more people to help with Clash. It's been interesting for the last several years that I've helped with Fusion, and then a couple of years ago I switched with the younger elementary school kids. I didn't know that I could handle the young elementary school kids. But you know what? Peter wouldn't have walked on water if he hadn't gotten out of the boat. So I really would suggest that if any of you have an inkling that you'd like to help, well, it's probably more than an inkling. It's probably God saying, I want you to help with Clash. And it doesn't matter if you're 26 or 86. God has a place for you. Last weekend, I was listening to AFR, American Family Radio Station, and there was a poem on there that I thought was very apropos to what we're going through, and I'd like to read it. It's called The Bridge Builder. An old man going a lone highway came at the evening cold and gray to a chasm vast and deep and wide, through which was flowing a sullen tide. The old man crossed in the twilight dim. The sullen stream had no fear for him, but he turned when safe on the other side and built a bridge to span the tide. Old man, said a fellow pilgrim neat, you're wasting your strength with building here. Your journey will end with the ending day. You never again will pass this way. You've crossed the chasm deep and wide. Why build this bridge at evening tide? The builder lifted his old gray head. Good friend, in the path I have come, he said, there followed after me today a youth whose feet must pass this way. This chasm that has been is not to me. To that fair-haired youth may a pitfall be. He too must cross in the twilight dim. Good friend, I am building this bridge for him. We'd appreciate it if you would help us build some bridges.
Thank you, Kent. Just kind of an update. I'd sent out a deal, and Pastor Dave, Pastor Cliff, somebody else sent out a thing. Just kind of on an update where we were. We need to really know. We need to have that number of volunteers by this Wednesday in order to make a decision to go forward. And we started out with 32, if you might remember. That was a big number. We were stuck on 19 for a while. But this morning, we were down to 12, I think it was, this morning when I announced. And right now, we're down to 9. So I just need nine people, and we can make this happen. So I'm God is at work, and I'm sure he's, yeah, here we go. The next announcement I have is Joni Adams. Going to share about Loaves of Love.
Woo! I always wanted to do that. I've watched Pastor Doug do that, and I want to be him when I grow up. And I tell him I'm his other mother. But I just want to say something about the Loaves of Love that we just came up with this outreach to just let people in the community, maybe people who haven't been able to attend services for a while, or that you would like to see become a member of our church or just come and worship with us, that If the Lord lays somebody on your heart, pick up a loaf of bread and a little note, and there are some suggested people, but maybe you already have people on your heart that you want to visit. I just want to say that there are lots of lonely people out there that are wanting people to love on them, wanting people to welcome them. And I don't know if you, the body of Christ, knows it or not, but you have a reputation in this town. When I tell people where I go to church, they say, "Oh, your church will take anybody." And I'm not sure what they mean by that, but I think I kind of like it. I like being a part of a church that will take anybody. So I also want to say that a big part of the reason that I am in this church is because Lindy Lindblad and Todd Catlin showed up on my doorstep with a fruit basket and invited us to this church. So some people are really hungry to come. They don't have the courage, or maybe don't feel welcome. If the Lord lays somebody on your heart, please stop by and pick up a loaf. Would you not let me in your door if I showed up with this loaf of bread? And pray over this bread and give the person a call and see if they would let you just come by and reach out to them.
Thank you, Joni. So just a few other things real quick. Amber Finney is one of the missionaries that we support as a church. She will be leaving to Peru, so there's a going away party for her this Saturday at Plum Creek from 2 to 5, if you would like to attend that and encourage her as she goes on her mission. Men's Encounter is coming up here January 27th through 29th. You can visit with Max Wehrman or Luke Schamber. Their information is in the bulletin. Luke also shared with me that next week they have an Encounter the Cross Sunday school time, which happens right before the service from 9:30 to about 10:15 or so. And next week, Charlie File will be sharing about a miraculous healing that has occurred. So that's all I know so far. So I'm a little intrigued and interested. A reminder that January 30th, we'll just have one worship service at 10 o'clock, plus there is a free meal, so that's a pretty sweet deal. January 30th, one worship service and a meal where we can all come together and fellowship together. Vertical Marriage Conference is happening on February 12th. There's information in the bulletin for that, including a little QR code that you can scan and get registered. If you need help, just let me know or stop by the Welcome Center. And a Weekend to Remember is an opportunity, which as a church, we would love to encourage you to invest more into your marriage, into maybe your future marriage if you're engaged or whatever it may be. See Pastor Dave for more information on that as well. And then you may have noticed the table for Heart Choices set up out there in the fellowship hall. Heart Choices has a video that we're going to pray. If you have questions or if you'd like to visit with them after the service, I would encourage you to stop by the table, but check out this video.
Something we all know, something we all feel, is that each person has value. From the youngest to the oldest, from the weakest to the strongest, from the most cautious to the most gregarious. Each person has value because God loves each one of us with His unending love. He first loved us, not because of our goodness, but because of His great love. And that love is not just for a few. It's for the entire world. God loves those in church today, and He loves those who have never attended. He loves those who seek Him daily and those who try to hide from Him their whole life. He loves those who are full of joy, and He loves those who are hurting and in need. And He loves and values those who are in plain view and those who are hidden and humble. Today on Sanctity of Human Life Sunday, we are able to join God in His love of babies, even before they are born. We can share God's heart for expecting mothers who are scared, excited, or unsure. we can give our prayers, our time, and our support to the least of these. And we can stand alongside God's righteous forgiveness of those who have experienced the pain of abortion. And we can share God's truth that each life created in His image is wonderfully made. On this Sanctity of Human Life Sunday, will you join us? God's deep and abiding love is given to each of us freely. Today is your opportunity to share that love with others. Please turn your hearts, minds, prayers, time, and support toward the choice of life. Help us educate and demonstrate God's truth that each person has value.
Each person has value. That truth started this meditation video, and it concluded that same video for Sanctity of Human Life Sunday today, January 16th. So what can we learn from this Sanctity of Human Life video? The reality of this truth that each person has value is known and felt by all. It begins with God's love for us. 1 John chapter 4 reminds us, this is love, not that we love God, but that He loved us and sent His Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. And God's love is for us all, no matter what our situation or circumstance. God loves those we can see, and He loves those pre-born that we can't see. The truth is that God, that each person has value, is related to the truth from Psalm 139:14 that states, I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. This video challenges us to turn our hearts, our minds, our prayers, our time, and our support to make the choice of life because each person has value. I would encourage you to stop by the Heart Choices display table in the Fellowship Hall. They have flyers, much information besides this, but this is one of the things. Each life is God's masterpiece. And you can read that, take it home with you, and study it and learn more about the ministry that Heart Choices has. You can also check out the baby bottle coin fundraising program that they have that is a way to invest your coins to make a difference for Heart Choices. We would do well to remember these truths about God as we pray together as a church family today. We already have joys and concerns that we shared in our earlier worship service that we'll include in our prayer time, and we have some items that have been passed on verbally to the pastoral staff. We'll include those. We have some items that we've received by text and email and Facebook instant message and other digital means, but we want to welcome the things that you would share right now, not only joys and concerns, but especially testimonies about what God is doing in and through your life, whatever's on your heart. We want to pray together as a church family about those things. What would you share as a prayer, joy, concern, or testimony? Yes. We appreciate you sharing the need that Brandon has tested positive for COVID, and we'll pray for God's grace as he works through that and hopefully is delivered to get well soon. Thank you. Other joys, concerns, and testimonies? Yes. We'll pray for a brother-in-law and cancer that's wrestling with prostate cancer and is causing problems. Thank you for sharing that. Other joys, concerns, and testimonies. We welcome the things that are on your heart. Whatever's on your heart, we want to pray together as a church family about those things. Yes. We'll pray for Josh Hallrich, and understand it was a very serious accident. The last I heard, he was still in ICU in Atlanta, Georgia. Thank you for sharing that. Other joys, concerns, and testimonies, yes. We will pray for Josh. It's very serious injuries, and as you mentioned, going to have surgery today, so we'll lift him up in prayer. I'm going to lead us in prayer in just a minute with a pattern of prayer. I see a hand over here. God bless you on your changing family dynamic. And okay. You bet. There was another hand over here, yes. We'll pray for Coulter, your brother, as he had his tonsils removed. Thank you for sharing that. I'm going to lead us in prayer with a pattern of prayer from Max Licato in his study called Before Amen. He identifies four different types or families of prayer. Those are, first, Father, you are good, focusing on God and praising him. Secondly, I need your help, talking about our own individual needs. And third, so do they, praying for others who need God's help. And then fourth, thank you in Jesus' name. I'm going to follow that outline as I offer some prayers. I want to encourage you to pray on your own in your own heart, and join me in your hearts as we go to the Lord together. Father, you are good. As I'm praying, I invite you to express your own praise to God in your own heart, however he prompts you. We do look to you. We worship you. We thank you for the praise team that reminds us that you never fail. You are faithful. Your word says that you are holy, loving, and sovereign. You alone are eternal, everlasting, and exalted. We want to share that relationship that you've given us with others, and we look to you because there's none other like you. We praise you with our lives. We lift our hands in your name. We lift our words in your name. Praise God. Praise God. I need help. As we continue on in our prayer time, I invite you to talk to God in your own heart about your own life, however he prompts you. 1 John 4:10 reminds us that this is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. We need your help. I need your help. I know it's only by the blood of Jesus that I have any hope of forgiveness and cleansing. I don't deserve it. I can't earn it. I can't pay it back. It's only by grace, only as I receive it as a gift. Therefore, I personally confess my sin, and I repent and humbly ask for your forgiveness, healing, and cleansing. They need help also. As we continue on in our prayer time, I invite you to talk to God in your heart praying for others however he prompts you. Lord, we want to lift concerns before you. We pray along with Josh for his brother Colter as he had his tonsils removed. Help him. We pray for the Dahl family and Rejoice and Ariel joining them as a foster child. And we pray for all the details related to the adjustments and changes and for wisdom and grace for all. Be with them. We pray for Josh Hollerick as it's mentioned that he had a serious accident. He and others were in. There were actually other people that passed away. And he's in ICU, going to have surgery today to clean the wound on his leg from where he lost part of his leg and work with the wounds on his arm. Lord, help him and give the doctors wisdom for all that concerns him. We pray along with Dave Cordell for brother-in-law in Wichita who has battling with prostate cancer. Help him with that situation. We pray along with Lori for son Branson in the Kansas City area, tested positive with COVID. We pray for God's grace and to get well soon. We pray along with the Reinerts for Oliver, who's going to be going to Kansas City later this month for eye treatment. We pray for wisdom for that. Our prayers continue along with Jennifer Greenwell, as she says online that our family is still struggling with the passing of Melva. And this week they had to say goodbye to Melva's dog. And it's just another reminder of the adjustments. And we pray for your grace and mercy for them. We pray along with Patty Blackmore for 75-year-old lady Barbara who fell and broke her arm in three places. No surgery needed, but needs lots of rest and healing, so be with her. We pray along with Rachel Ducote as she shared an email this week about prayers for Josh as he still has a stomach pain that's undiagnosed. And pray for wisdom for direction and healing. We pray for the men's encounter, that men would be prompted to benefit and to participate in the men's encounter coming up later this month in Salina. We pray along with Suzanne Wehrman for Glenn Luke, as he has a special program that's going to be starting training young people, 45 folks who are going to be studying starting January 5th, and we pray for that over a period of weeks. We also pray for a gathering of believers from six different countries that will be coming in the near future. We pray for the details related to that. We pray for the Sanctity of Human Life Sunday that we've already talked about, and we pray that you would help us to recognize and celebrate life. We also pray for the holiday tomorrow, Martin Luther King Day, that reminds us also that every person has value. We should recognize and celebrate that. Our praise continue. For Amber Finney, as she has a launching celebration coming up before she leaves for her term of service in Peru. Be with her and encourage her. We pray along with Renee Mason for Bryce and Jackie Paulson as they battle sickness. Help them, we pray. We pray for with Susan Graybon for her mother-in-law as she has health concerns and those that she's with are struggling with health concerns. Pray along with Mary Maxwell for Eric Dunston as he has hip replacement surgery scheduled for tomorrow, January 17th. Be with him, we pray. We pray along with Tom Maxwell for 53-year-old cousin Von Studer as he'll be having double heart surgery coming up this next week. We pray for him and lift him before your throne. We pray with Sherry Angel for her mom, as her mom has a severe coughing concern and needs your touch. We pray along with Lorelei for her sister Jennifer in Chicago, as she was treated for cervical cancer and was given a bill of health from that, but then discovered in December that she now has cancer to deal with in her stomach and lungs. We pray for her healing, and we pray for Jennifer's husband Don, as he's a caregiver and he'd recently lost his sister to lung cancer. Help them both to draw closer to God and experience his healing presence and love. Our prayers continue for Roger Thielander as he adjusts to the effects of a stroke. We pray for Ron Pontier as he adjusts to the chemo that he's received. We pray for Heart Choices, our local mission that you would provide for their financial needs, that you would enable, empower, and encourage them as they seek to provide help, hope, and healing to many people as they serve. Pray for the Loaves of Love program, that it would make a difference in the hearts of those who have a chance to be served. We pray for the miracle needed for 9 more volunteers to help for the CLASH program to continue. Prompt the hearts of those who hear, we pray. We pray for those who have experienced passing of loved ones. We pray along with Jeff Chrisman for the family of his dad, as his dad passed away last week and his funeral will be tomorrow in Nebraska. Send comfort and peace. We also pray for the family of Jerry Dival as he passed away last week. Send comfort and peace, we pray. Be with Pastor Cliff to fill, anoint, and use him as he shares about cultivating our soul and discipleship today. And we pray for the Holy Spirit to prompt the heart of each one who hears, both here and online, that we may each sense whatever the next step is for our spiritual journey. Thank you, Lord. As we continue on in our prayer time, I invite you to talk to God, thanking him in your own heart, however he prompts you. Thank you for this church family and the opportunity to share together on our spiritual journey. And thank you for each one, because each is valuable and special and important. We give you praise along with Sherry Angel for the birth this last week of grandson William John Angel. We receive prayer updates as impending birth was approaching, and we're glad to know that the new baby has arrived and the mom and baby are doing well. Be with them, we pray. We pray along with Jody File as she gave thanks and testified about the appreciation and support of the church family for her and Bill as he went through his hip replacement surgery and recovery. We continue to pray that you would be with him. Our prayers continue as we give you praise with Billy Matlock as he was baptized in this sanctuary a week ago. We pray that you continue to show yourself strong on his behalf. And we give you praise along with Terry Jennings for the birth of his first grandchild earlier this month, Wesley Sean Jennings. We give you thanks for our church and the activities of the last year as we have the annual reports available, and we pray that hearts would be encouraged as we review what you've been at work doing in and through our church family. Lord, we pray and give thanks for the sanctity of human life, which focus on the family describes as we believe that the human life is of inestimable worth and significance in all its dimensions, including the unborn, the aged, the widowed, the mentally handicapped, the unattractive, the physically challenged, and every other condition in which humanness is expressed from conception to the grave. So, Lord, this is my prayer of complete surrender to you. God, you are the potter, and I am the clay. I am broken and marred and needy in many ways, especially regarding this sanctity human life topic. Thank you for not leaving me in my brokenness. I need your help right now. Hear me. Prompt me regarding what the next step is for me, and I invite you to remake me, to reshape me, and transform me. I pray all this in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Good morning, church. Can I tell you, it is so great to see you here. I don't know if you know it, but your presence here when you come fills the heart of the people around here. So thank you for taking the time to come. This is the third Sunday in January. So how well are you guys doing with your New Year's resolutions? Very good. I bet you beat me. I didn't make it 24 hours. While I was eating ice cream, I remembered, oh yeah, this is January 1st, and I was going to change. So it didn't last long. But what is it about change that's so difficult? I think as you think about it, a lot of times when it really comes down to it, it's fear. It's the fear of the unknown, fear of rejection, fear of failure. of your change, even when we know it's something that we should do and it's something that's better for us. Well, this scripture is one of my favorites, 2 Timothy 1:7. For the Spirit God gave us does not make us timid, but gives us power, love, and self-discipline. Let me read that again. 2 Timothy 1:7. For the Spirit God gave us does not make us timid, but gives us power, love, and self-discipline. Doesn't that sound kind of how fear goes away? Those things help with what we're struggling with. If he gives us those things, don't you think he wants us to do something with it? Most of those are actions. And so, what are we going to do with it? What is God constantly wanting to do? He's wanting us to grow. And how do we grow? Sometimes that's stretching us into places and positions that we are not comfortable with. Gets us out of our comfort zone and out of our box. But whatever he's working on you, know that you aren't alone. He has given us this word to light our path. Like Psalm 119:105 says, your word is a lamp for my feet, a light on my path. So if with anything new, you may not know what to do, but his word is what I would suggest turning to, because it will light your path. It will give you guidance in areas where you're not quite sure. And there's other body members that are here to help you with that. Deacons, would you please come forward? This is our time for communion. If you have received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, we invite you to take communion with us. Just come down the center aisles. There are two cups. Take both of them. Step off to the side and take your time and do this in remembrance of Jesus. When you're done, there's receptacles. You can put them down, go around, and sit down. We also have offering boxes at the back if you are felt led to give. And if you want to stay seated, just raise your hand and we'll come by and serve you. Would you pray with me, please? Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so very much for this church, for these people, these brothers and sisters that have come and made this a priority in their day, that have come when there are so many other things that they could be doing. But we're here together to worship, to fill our hearts from each other. We lift this up in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'm going to project. Oh, there we go. There we go. Yeah, it's good to have you here this morning. Thanks for coming. I want to get into God's Word, and so if you have a Bible, I think you'll find it helpful if you can follow along in your own Bible. We have Bibles to give away out at the Welcome Center. We'd love to get one in your hands if you don't have one of your own, but we'll also have it on the screen here. We're looking today at 1 Corinthians chapter 9, 1 Corinthians 9 verses 24 through 27. So just a few verses this morning. We're continuing in a series, which I'll mention in just a little bit, but let me read this text first, but always with this reminder, this remembrance, this is God's Word, inspired by the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit is present with us today, and so let's listen for the Holy Spirit to speak to each one of us. Do you not know that in a race, all the runners run, but only one gets the prize? Run in such a way as to get the prize. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last, but we do it to get a crown that will last forever. Therefore, I do not run like someone running aimlessly. I do not fight like a boxer beating the air. No, I strike a blow to my body and make it my slave, so that after I have preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified for the prize. Let's take a moment to pray. Help us, Lord, by your Spirit, teach us, guide us, help our hearts and minds to be open, so that we can receive what you would give us today. Change the way we think, change what we believe, Lord, and ultimately change the way we live. And we pray that you do this for your glory, for our good and the good of others. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So this series that we've been looking at, these five different, you can call them love expressions, because ultimately, the goal that God has for us is that we become people who love God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love people like we love ourselves. But there are different ways in which we express that love. And so we're trying to just take a look at each one of these areas that the Scriptures will talk about, but then try to help us see what's the next step. Just take the next step is kind of the idea behind this series. No matter where you're at right now, because nobody's at the same place, but God meets you right where you're at. He comes to meet us where we're at. He doesn't wait and say, hey, once you get kind of fixed up or get a little bit better in this whole deal, then I'll meet you. He meets you right where you're at, and then God says, I want you to just to take the next step. So in each one of these areas, we're looking at next steps. The last 2 weeks, we looked at celebrating in worship. How can we grow and take a next step in expressing our love for God in worship, and we looked at some areas there. We looked last week at communicating in evangelism. So how can I grow? How can I take a next step in sharing the hope that you have? If you have hope in Jesus, that you're able to share the reason for that hope with people who would ask and notice that you have that hope. Today, we look at one. I'm using the C's, you know, the five C's here. This C today is cultivate. It's an agricultural term. You see a lot of metaphors and analogies in the Bible that use agriculture, things that grow, to kind of get a picture of what it's like to have a relationship with God. And so to cultivate Christ-likeness, to cultivate the life of Jesus that lives in you, the moment that you say yes to Jesus, that you surrender your life, you're no longer in charge of it, but you surrender your life and say to Jesus, you're Savior, save me from my sins, but you're also Lord. That means you rule my life. And once the moment that you do that, the moment that you receive Christ, the Holy Spirit of God causes you to be born again and he dwells within you. You actually have Christ living in you by the Holy Spirit. And our goal here is to say, so once Christ is in us, how can we cultivate his life so that more and more, when we look at each other, I look at you and I say, I see Jesus in you. I see Jesus in you. and that you're able to say that to me more and more, that we cultivate his life in such a way that it begins to show out to everyone. So looking at this today, Paul uses some metaphors here, more athletic imagery in these few verses here, but he wants us to understand that this whole idea of cultivating Christ-likeness, becoming more and more like Jesus in our nature and our character, hits right on your purpose for living. It's right at the heart of why you're here, your life purpose. And life purpose really matters. I was reading something about how life expectancy has continued to trend up. When you look especially over the last couple hundred years where the life expectancy was in the 30s or 40s, you'd live to be 30 or 40-something before you died, and now life expectancy is 60s, 70s, and how that has continued to kind of grow, and medical advances and better hygiene, cleaner water, those things all play a part of that. But somebody noted one of the biggest blunders that human beings make is that we are keeping ourselves alive longer without knowing why we should. We're staying alive a lot longer, but we don't really know why. What's my purpose? What is life really about? There was a group of guys that was talking about purpose. They were a little bit older. Some were retired and some were getting close to retirement age, and they were talking together. One guy in his 50s said, "I cannot wait until I retire." And the other guy said, "What are you going to do when you retire?" He said, "When I retire, I'm going to sit on the couch every day and just watch TV every day." And most of the guys were just really quiet until one guy spoke up and he said, "If you do that, you'll be dead within a year. Because if the lack of purpose in your life doesn't kill you first, your wife probably will," right? You got to have more than this. Is at the core of it, is what Paul is saying. The core of your life comes down to what Paul would say is this prize. It's about becoming like Christ. By the way, this fits in your particular life purpose, fits into the grand scheme of all of human history. It really does. It goes to the very beginning. When God created all things, he created it good. Sin enters into God's good creation and distorts especially his very highest of creation, human beings made in God's image, and it begins to distort how we were created to be. And then God says, "But I love you too much. I could wipe you all out and start fresh. But God says, I see in you someone who has great worth in my sight. And I'm not willing to do that. In fact, I will go to such great lengths to redeem you, distorted by sin, that I will send my one and only son. And I will give him as a sacrifice for your sins, that whoever believes in him will not perish but have eternal life." And so you have creation, you have sin, you have redemption. And then God says, but it's not just about getting your sins forgiven. We talk about the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ. And a lot of times the emphasis of that goes to you get your sins forgiven. That means no more guilt, no more shame, no more condemnation. And that is certainly one of the biggest parts of what we talk about the gospel, but it's not the only part. The gospel is not only that you get forgiven. The gospel is that you get remade from the inside out. That God says, that old distorted nature, I'm going to forgive the sins, but I want to create in you such a heart that you won't sin. I want to create in such a heart of you that you reflect the very image of God as you were intended to. And so when we talk about purpose, your life's purpose, the gospel proclaims this, is to be remade in the image of Christ. That is the ultimate reason to get up in the morning. That's why God has created us. So the gospel begins with our purpose, not about doing. Because see, when we say, what's my purpose in life? The first thing we all want to say is, well, what should I be doing, right? What am I doing? And the Bible consistently says, purpose begins with being. Who are you? Who are you becoming? Being before doing. Be, then do. Be, do. Do-be-do-be-do, right? I mean, that's the way it works. Always being, if you make a tree good, Jesus says, the fruit, what you do, is going to be really good. But you've got to start with who you're becoming. Who am I becoming? Well, the Bible says, oh, this is on God's heart so much. This is on so many different scriptures. Let me just read a few for you that are pretty powerful. Dear friends, now, when you're in Christ, now we are children of God. And what we will be has not yet been made known. We're not complete yet. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. I hope that hits you. We're going to be like him. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son. And we all, who with unveiled faces contemplate the Lord's glory, are being transformed into his image with ever-increasing glory. Put on the new self, which is being renewed in the knowledge in the image of its creator. This is what Paul means in our passage as the prize. Run the race in such a way as to get that. That's the prize. That's what life is about. That's the purpose of your life. Run in such a way, live in such a way to get that prize. This is the only purpose that lasts. You can have lots of different goals in life, a purpose in your life. You may say, well, I want to be successful at my job. I want to make some money. I want to have some success in that area. That's all fine, but it's not going to last. That's why Paul says in our text, you know what, you can get a crown that might last a little bit but won't last for very long, but you can get a crown that'll last forever. That prize won't last, though. Success, wealth, money, you're not taking it with you. All that gets left behind, death strips it away. Well, but maybe it's about, you know, certain relationships. Maybe if I get married, that's my ultimate purpose in life. Well, that's great, but it's till death do you part. Well, maybe it's to become physically attractive or maybe athletically superior to others. I hate to tell you this, because it's really hard for some people to believe it, but you're getting older, right? I mean, it's starting to, as Paul says, we are wasting away on the outside. I'm looking at my hands the other day, and I'm like, man, alive, this is like my parents' hands. How did I get my parents' hands on me suddenly? And I know some of you are sitting there, you're too young right now. You're like, that's not happening to me, Cliff. And we just want you to know, we love you, we really do, and we can't wait for it to happen to you, because, man, alive, we'll be able to say, see, it doesn't last. It just doesn't last. So outwardly, we can waste away, but what prize could we possibly have in life that will go on forever? And it is to have this remade character. Who you're becoming, whatever track you're on right now, is what's going to last forever. Because your body's going to die, but your soul is going to go on. And the only question is, which direction, what prize is your soul aimed for every day? You kind of see this even in reverse sometimes. So you ever know somebody who, if you've known them for a long time, you might say something like, you know what, they're stubborn, just really, really stubborn person. And the longer that you know them, does that stubbornness get better or worse over time? A lot of times you look at somebody like, man, they were stubborn, but they are so much more stubborn now. The older they get, it seems to get worse and worse. Or somebody who has an anger problem. Man, they've got a real anger issue. They've had it for a long time, but it's not the same. It keeps getting a little bit worse and a little bit worse. And at some point you say, how bad would it be if that anger continues, if that greed continues on that trajectory, if they live to be 100, how bad will it be at that point? You say, well, it could be pretty bad. How bad would it be if they lived to be 400 years old? How bad would that anger be then? How bad would it be if you stretch it out for eternity? It would literally be hell. When the Bible talks about hell, it's not just talking about an external place that's just terrible. It's talking about the fact that your soul itself, which in sin is turned in on itself, will grow worse and worse and worse unless the redeeming act of God begins a work in your life where now you're being remade And the whole course, the whole direction, the whole prize is entirely different now, because then those things get better and better too. What would love look like as it gets into eternity? What would joy, some people have joy working in their life and it's getting better and better, and you're like, well, man, by the time they're 100, it would be pretty good. What happens stretched out over eternity? What about peace? What about patience? What about kindness and goodness? What about faithfulness and gentleness and self-control? Yes, these are the fruit of the Spirit. When those characteristics that are happening now, and are not perfectly happening now yet, we all fall short, we mess this up, but as those things continue to grow throughout eternity, what's that look like? And guess what? We don't have to guess. We don't have to speculate. I can tell you exactly what that will look like. It will look like Jesus. That's what Jesus is. The fruit of the Spirit is no other than a description of the character of Jesus, that now he's working in his people progressively, and so now his people cultivate the life of Christ. That's our purpose. That's the prize that we're after. But here's where, in this sermon, it'd be really easy at this point to say, I think, Pastor Cliff's point, I got to try harder to be like Jesus. Like, that's the point of the sermon, or whatever it is, I be like Jesus, okay, I got to try harder to do that. But here's a really, really important point. There is a difference, a vast difference between trying and training. And the reason that so many people get frustrated in the Christian life is because we are trying so hard to be like Jesus, and we're not training to be like Jesus. Dallas Willard has really done great work in his books to kind of spell this out. A big difference between trying and training. My best personal example of this, some of you have heard this story before, sorry about that, but here you go again. It's July 4th, 1987. I was 23 years old. Laura and I were living down in Sterling, Kansas. And on July 4th, I don't know if they still do this, but they had what they called a freedom run. It should be a freedom not to run, but they have a freedom run. They would run from Lyons High School down Highway 14 all the way down to Sterling Lake there, and they would run this course on July 4th. It was a competitive. Now, at 23 years old, I was in really good shape. I mean, I was in pretty good shape at 23 years old. I was cocky. I really was, because I would get of course, this isn't great competition, but I'd get my Bible profs to go play basketball with me, and I would just dominate them. I mean, I was just constantly kind of lording it over him, my one Bible prof. And so my one Bible prof said to me one day, he said, Cliff, they got this freedom run, July 4th. Would you like to run the freedom run? I said, okay, well, how long is it? He said, it's 15K. No one actually knows how long a kilometer is, but if you want to get a guess of it, by the way, 15K, I looked it up, is exactly 9.32057 miles. And if you don't think the 057 is important and you have not run the Freedom Run on July 4th, I said, 9 miles, so we run from Lyons to Sterling, 9 miles? I said, sure, no problem. I'm in great shape. My Bible prof, he looked ancient. He was probably in his 40s, but he looked really, really old to me. And I'm like, oh, there's no way. I will beat this guy, because this was a competition in my mind. He's like, great. Here's where we show up. We show up that day. I showed up that day. I actually woke up, I think, like a half hour before the race started. Got up to Lyons there, and I had just rolled out of bed. I was like, I don't think I need any breakfast. No big deal. I don't think I need any water. No big deal. This run will be over in no time. And so we start this run, and my Bible prof is running next to me, and it's actually pretty easy. I mean, I felt pretty bad, because I thought, man, I'm going to stay with him for the first couple of miles that we go here, but after that, I'm just going to take off. And he was right with me, first 2, 3, 4, 5 miles. It was 104 degrees on July 4th, 1987. I know every time I tell this story, it gets a little hotter, so it was around 104 degrees, and we're running, and we got about halfway through, so about 4 mile marker, and I had an out-of-body experience. I know it was, because my body really wasn't with me anymore from mile four markers on. My body just was beginning to refuse, which I'd never experienced before, refuse to do what I wanted it to do. And my Bible prof is just chugging along, and I've stopped talking at this point, and he just keeps yapping away. He's got all kinds of air, and he's just running with ease, and I'm starting to fall behind. And so what do? You try harder. That's what you do. I don't want to be embarrassed. I can promise you this. On that day, and there were a lot of runners, no one ran with more effort than me. No one tried harder than me. I promise you that. It was not for lack of effort. But at some point, I just couldn't keep running. I mean, so there I am, halfway between Lyons and Sterling on a 107-degree day, and I can't do it. I mean, it's just not in my body to do it. And the problem was not trying. The problem was what? Cliff, you didn't train. Yeah, but I'm trying as hard as I possibly can. There is a big difference between trying and training. And in the Christian life, we try so hard, but we don't train. And Paul is telling us, let me give you this sports metaphor, he says. When athletes go for this crown that's not even going to last, this prize that won't even last, they don't just try hard. They go into strict training. They are eyeballed on the prize, and they say, but I will never get there by just trying harder. Paul's point is to go into strict training, because here's the thing. To train for something is to do something that in itself is not the goal, but it will help you strengthen for the goal. Okay? Let me say that again. To train is to do something that in itself is not the goal, but it will strengthen you for the goal. So we got football players. Football players, when it's off season, they're pumping weights. There has never been a football game on this planet where somebody gets points for bench pressing on the sideline. Nobody gets points for football players. Yeah, but I bench pressed my personal best this past week. How many points for that do I get? You get nothing for that, right? Except by benching, by pushing weights, what am I doing? I'm training for the game, because I'm not going to break that tackle. I'm not going to be able to block like I should. That will actually gain us points, unless I do this thing that in itself gets me nothing. I'm a basketball player. I love basketball. Every time you talk about basketball training, what is it? Run. Here, we'll put these lines. Just run to these lines. And the coach is just run, 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 run. Why? How many points do I get for running in a basketball game? Zero. At my age, I should get something. I get nothing for running up and down a court. 0 points. But if I don't run, there's no way that I'm going to have the energy to actually shoot and score and box out and do everything that you need to do in a basketball game to win the prize. So now the question is, so what is it in the Christian life that I should be training to do that in itself is not the goal? That's the problem here. It'd be easy to just say, that's what I'm really after. No, no, that's not my prize. My prize is to become like Jesus. A loving person who loves God and loves people. What will train me in this? Well, there's where we get to what we call, I hate to use this word because it doesn't sound very attractive, but spiritual disciplines. Spiritual disciplines or spiritual exercises. Paul puts it this way, and this doesn't sound very appealing either. No, I strike a blow to my body and I make it my slave so that after I have preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified for the prize. It's about the prize. What's the prize? Becoming like Christ, becoming a loving person as God intended me to be. So let me give this working definition of what a spiritual discipline or a spiritual training exercise is. It's any activity or experience that I either choose to do, like it's very intentional, there are things that I can choose to do for spiritual training, or, my wife always puts it this, I hate this when she says this, because an invitation from God through a circumstance that comes to me that I didn't choose, right? But there's an invitation from God. She's absolutely right. This circumstance, these events that are happening in your life, they can become spiritual training. They aren't just in themselves spiritual training. I'm going to have to respond to them. But it's any activity or experience that I either choose to do or that comes to me in the natural flow of the day that can help me to gain strength to live a life of love like Jesus. That's what a spiritual discipline is. There are particular ones that you know of. If you haven't, these are kind of the standard ones. That there's kind of fundamental ones like reading God's word, like praying. We'll get to some others in just a moment here. But here's the first thing I want to say. They're not necessarily unpleasant. We have this weird connotation with them that it can't be good for me unless I dislike it kind of thing. It's sort of like spiritual cauliflower, like you choke down cauliflower and be like, good job, way to go, you ate it. It's like, no, that's not what spiritual discipline. I think the reason spiritual disciplines and training exercises in becoming like Christ get a bad rap is because there are some wrong ideas that people have attached to them. Can I just mention that quickly so you can avoid it? Doing these spiritual disciplines, they are not to try to get God's approval or favor. They become deadly. If you set about and say, well, I read my Bible and I pray, I go to worship and I want to fast and I want to do these spiritual disciplines so that maybe finally I will get God's approval, you aren't functioning within the gospel. You're functioning under religion and not relationship with Christ. You're trying to gain God's approval, that's religion. But if you have received it by grace, you know you didn't deserve it, but you get it by grace, now I do these things, but for a whole different motive. So spiritual disciplines are not to try to get God's approval or favor. It's not trying to do, I always hated kids in school that did this, extra credit. And the teacher would say, I got this extra credit thing. I don't think I ever did an extra credit project in my whole life through school, but I would see other students do it, and I was like, oh, they're kissing up to the teacher. Because anybody who does the extra credit, the teacher's going to look on favorably, right? That's not the way it is with God. You're not doing spiritual disciplines so that you kind of do extra credit with God. It's not, I don't know your background, but it's not to do penance for sins that you've committed. You cannot make up for your sin by trying to do some spiritual activities. Well, maybe that'll cover it. If you're in Christ, your sin is covered by the blood of Christ. Nothing is going to cover it better than the blood of Christ. So anything you do in response to that is to say simply, God, I'm so grateful that my sins are covered. This is not trying to do penance for sins. And they are not an end in themselves. It's not to do them just for themselves, but for the goal of how do I get stronger in love? So spiritual disciplines, by the way, are for our good. And you will enjoy them. Some of them you will absolutely enjoy and don't feel bad about it, right? Think about this. I thought, what does it take to be a loving person? I mean, a really loving person to other people. It takes a lot of energy. I can tell you that right now. Think about this. If you're going to be a really loving person, that means when they're talking, you have to be an engaged listener. You have to be able to put a lot of attention and focus and not have your mind wander about what I'm going to say next, but like you really care about what they're saying. That takes a lot of mental and emotional energy to do that, right? If you're going to serve someone's needs, not on your schedule, but when they actually need it, it's going to take a lot of energy to put your schedule down and to say, God, if you're calling me to do this now, here I am, use me. It takes a lot of energy. And so one of the most practical things that it kind of hit me right away was, one of the most important spiritual disciplines is getting rest, because you can't love people when you're burned out. Like, you cannot love people when you're absolutely fried because your schedule is so busy that you're running from one thing to the next, to the next, to the next, and you're trying to squeeze God and being a good Christian and all that stuff into it. But if you're not getting rest, you're not going to love people well. We get hangry. Well, we get also pretty nasty when we don't get enough rest. And to have that, wasn't it Jesus himself who actually said to his disciples, stop doing ministry. Come away with me by yourselves and get some rest. It was Jesus who said that. Remember a prophet Elijah? He was burned out. He was doing everything he could for God, but he got so burned out, not enough rest. And when he makes this trek into the desert, God makes him do this, not take just one nap. He makes him take two naps in the wilderness. He makes him rest, and he gives him food and good stuff to drink and eat. He said, this journey's way too long for you. You're not getting enough rest. Spiritual disciplines sometimes are going to feel so refreshing to you. It's not just eating spiritual cauliflower. It's this ability to say, God, what do I need to do? What do I need to grow to be strengthened to love? That's what a spiritual discipline is. Paul says, I strike a blow to my body. And what he's trying to say is, Dallas Willard was really known for this. Dallas Willard said, habits eat willpower for breakfast every morning. Habits eat up your willpower. So in other words, you make up your mind, I'm going to do this. Here's my willpower. Here's my determination. And he says, I don't care what you've done there. Whatever habits you have in place in your life are going to eat that up. It's going to overwhelm it. That's why we get depressed for resolutions. I had my willpower, but my habits. So the key for spiritual disciplines is, how can I change my habits? How can I actually start to create holy habits in my life? Because those habits are going to carry me. They're going to carry the day. So God, how can I develop new habits in my life? And if you're already, again, feeling anxious about this, oh my word, I got to add 10 more things to my life right now. Pastor Cliff wants me to do this and this and this. And if I was thinking about this as I was reading, putting this message together. If there's, especially like parents right now, God bless you. Man, we're praying for you. You got the hardest job in the world. You really do. And I was thinking about, so what about a stay-at-home mom? And you've got 2-3 kids or more, and you're doing the battle every day. You're saying, oh, I already feel guilty because, man, one, talk about habits. I don't even get to choose when I get up, right? It's when the rugrats get up. That's when I got to get up. Is when they get up, that's when I get up. I'm not ready to get up, but it's time to get up. And then they're off and running, and I'm trying to keep up with them. And the house is a mess, and I've got laundry piled everywhere. I've got peanut butter I'm trying to get out of my hair. I don't know how that got there. There's mac and cheese that's in a drawer somewhere. How did that get there? And I'm fighting this battle every day. And you talk about, wow, it'd be great to get some quiet time with God. I would love some quiet time, Cliff. But I can't see it happening. You talk about sweet hour of prayer. There are some parents I know that lie to their children that they have to go to the bathroom just so they get 5 minutes alone in the bathroom, right? Because I just need a little bit of time, but it's, how do I squeeze in more? And this is where you have to change your thinking. Spiritual disciplines just aren't about what you choose to do, but it's what God has laid before you. And here is a mom who's probably thinking, well, it only counts if I have a quiet time with God. It all counts if you look at it and say, well, what, God, can you do in me raising these children to strengthen me in love? And there's almost nothing better in the world for training you to love than parenting. It moves you away from self-centeredness. I promise you, you don't have time to be self-centered. Your focus is towards others. Oh, God, then strengthen me in that way. Do you understand the spiritual discipline of child, of raising children? That's a spiritual discipline if it's not just happening, but as it's happening, it's an invitation from God. And I say, God, my patience is really worn thin, but I need patience if I'm going to love others too. Can you grow me in my patience through child rearing? By the way, marriage is another really good spiritual discipline. If you're in a marriage and your life is busy and hectic, you're like, I don't have time to do. Your marriage itself becomes a spiritual discipline. If I say to the Lord, Lord, let me receive this as an invitation to look to the needs and interests of others before my own. And marriage can teach you that. Marriage can train you in that. And you're developing these muscles to love the fruit of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, all of those things can become part of the actual routine of our lives. Those are spiritual disciplines. So let me just give you these steps to kind of wrap this up. I've been praying, okay, God, just one step. Take whoever is listening, whatever you implant on their heart, then go with it. You're like, well, what are some chosen spiritual disciplines? Well, there is scripture, reading scripture. Like, well, yeah, I've been trying to do that. How often are you doing it? I don't know, it's kind of random, maybe once every other day, maybe once a week. Wherever you're at, and if you're like, well, honestly, not at all. I'm not reading any scripture. I come to church, you guys read it, but I don't really read it on my own. Wherever you're at, your next step is just to say, God, let me get into your word. Like, instead of making a grand plan, I'm going to read through the Bible in 5 days or something like that, maybe one verse, God, and just let it marinate in my head for a week. And every day I just read one verse. Takes me 10 seconds to read the verse. Maybe that's your step. Maybe it's prayer. Do you pray? When? Is it a crisis that prompts it? That's okay. God is not resentful. If you're saying, you know what, the only time I really pray is when I got a problem. Isn't it so great that God never gets resentful and says, well, haven't heard from you for a long time. Now you want some help? Well, too bad. God says, oh, I love it when you come to me. But God, grow me in trusting you and looking to you and showing my dependence on you by, let me pray at least once every day. Maybe it's the spiritual discipline of celebration and joy and gratitude. Some of you do this really, really well. Some of you have developed a holy habit of being able to look at whatever is going on in your life at any particular time and saying, yep, I'm not in denial. That's not a good thing. Yep, that's a hard circumstance. Yep, that's painful. But I see something good here. I see something I can give thanks to God. And that spiritual discipline of expressing gratitude really is, this is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. It's not saying, let me check my circumstances first. Let me see how the stocks are doing. Let me see how all this has happened. No, it's just, this is the day God has made. So that in itself is enough to begin to celebrate and rejoice, God, in you, because you're good and you're working for our good. Maybe it's beginning to make fasting a part of your life, a habit. That's removing something from your life, right? Most often we talk about fasting in terms of food. I'm going to skip this meal. Don't just do it as an end in itself. Well, I skipped the meal, so God must be happy with me somehow. No, God, I want to not eat at this particular time because maybe food has gotten a hold of me. Maybe food is my comfort that I run to before I run to you, God. Maybe I've covered my life with not just food, but a whole lot of other things. And if you tell me, God, if you point this out, if you help me to give up Facebook for a week, help me to give up social media. Some of you are like, a week? How about an hour? Okay, let's start at an hour, right? We're going to start wherever you're at and say, God, what happens in me when I don't have that? Now, if you're like me, I always thought I failed fasting because I got hangry. I get hangry all the time. And whenever I try to fast, I'm not a real nice guy to be around. And I always thought, there's the failure, because God wants me to fast so that I'm all happy and gay, and oh, I wish I just never ate again, or anything like that. Instead, God's like, no, the point of it was to bring that to the surface. Cliff, I already knew that was there. You just had it covered with a lot of stuff, but now that it's out, that's a success. That's success. So spiritual disciplines are sort of like physical exercise. Do you ever start to work out when you haven't worked out for a while? And the next day, whoo, was that a failure? Not at all. The actual pain that you feel is a sign that you did it right. You're doing something right, because what you've just done, you're growing your strength, your muscles, spiritually the same thing. The pain that you feel in some of these things is a sign that God is strengthening you to love. That's the goal. That's the prize, to look like Christ. Maybe it's solitude and silence. This one freaks people out. When we say, hey, maybe God is calling you to turn everything off and just be in silence for 10 minutes or an hour or a day. Oh, it freaks people out. I got to have the radio on. I got to have my cell phone in front of me. I got to have something stimulating me. What would happen if I gave that up? Well, God says, from that, that's not the end in itself, but from that, maybe I would begin to train you. You would be training in this ability to be kind, because you can't be kind if you're not paying attention. You can't have kindness in your life if you're not paying attention. And maybe being in solitude and silence refocuses your muscles, your spiritual muscles, for paying attention to the needs of others, where they're at. We do these things, but I want to give you this encouragement. Only God causes the growth. So if you take this and you say, oh, okay, here's my challenge. All right, it's not in itself. I got to add these spiritual disciplines. I want to do something to strengthen my ability to love. It's not all on you. So we've read these passages before where it's God is the only one who makes things grow. So there's the freedom that we have in this, is to try, feel like I've messed it up or failed, but to understand that on your worst possible day as a Christian, and you say, it's a failing grade, I blew it in so many ways today, on your worst day, the Holy Spirit is still functioning at 100% in you. The Holy Spirit is not stumped, oh gosh, I don't know what to do with them now because they really messed up. The Holy Spirit's like, I'm greater than that. And the Holy Spirit is saying, I love these passages that say, God began a good work in you and he will bring it to completion. Nothing is going to stop God from remaking you into the image of Christ. The big thing is, will you participate in his work? And if you do, you will experience joy because your life is becoming what it was meant to be. But more than that, your life becomes salt and light to people around you. One of the primary ways in which people can come to Christ is when they see that you are changing your nature, your character. I came to Christ through my mom. My mom invited me to church, and that was good. I needed to go to church. That's not what drew me to Christ ultimately. My mom told me about the gospel. I needed to hear it. I didn't understand it. I needed her to share with me what the gospel is. But that's not what ultimately drew me to Christ. You know what drew me to Christ? Seeing Jesus grow and form in my mom. My mom was a rough character. I was just kind of going through her life a little bit, thinking about this. My mom, I mean, she was just a strong, she still is. She's a strong-willed person. She's a person who, she quit high school to run away to get married, and her dad was a cop in Pennsylvania and had the entire police force, the state police of Pennsylvania, looking for her, and my mom's like, I don't care, and she ran across the border and got married to my dad. I still don't know if they're legally married all these years, but they got married. My mom comes back. She's this strong-willed, nobody's going to break her, and I grew up with this thought that no one's greater than my mom. There's no power in the universe greater than my mom. But then I saw these changes. And some of them happened pretty quick, but some of them took time. The first thing I saw was mom started reading the Bible. She never read the Bible. We didn't even have Bibles in our home. And my mom is reading the scriptures. More than that, she's telling me there's an authority that's greater than her that she's coming under. What? Mom, you don't come under any authority. I come under the authority of the Word of God. And there was something there that was like, that is dramatically different. There's something, I see something in my mom there. Praying, I never saw my mom pray before she became a believer. Ever, not even once. My dad was sick, he had ALS, and never saw my mom pray, never talked about prayer. Suddenly I'm seeing my mom pray regularly. It's a holy habit that's suddenly happening in her life. She's praying, and she is acknowledging, this was what blew me away, she's acknowledging dependence on God. Mom, you don't depend on anybody. Your whole life is built on being independent. And now she's expressing her dependence on God. My mom is the most stubborn person in the entire world. I promise you this. She's stubborn in getting her own way. And God took and transformed that into a faithfulness. She's still stubborn. She's still stubborn for Jesus. She's stubborn for love. Because if my mom says, and she sees you, and she's going to love on you, I promise you, you're going to be loved to the end of your days. She is faithful. She is transforming, though. It's not about her, it's about others. My mom had serious anger issues, really bad anger issues, and she used her anger to get her way, to control situations. She would flat out intimidate people to make sure that she got control of a situation. And suddenly I'm beginning to see this change inside of my mom, where she had this love that expressed itself as, I'm going to trust God with this. I don't have to control it. I'd never seen that in my mom before. My mom had these wild emotional swings. She would go to the highest highs and then plummet to the lowest of lows. And as a kid, you're always trying to figure that out. How can I make sure I don't press the wrong button and do the wrong thing or say the wrong thing? And these wild emotional swings. And it didn't change just overnight, but suddenly there was something else in play here. It was sort of this steady joy. Like there was a joy even when things were hard. There was a joy, not happiness, a joy that was just straight lining in her life. And I'd never seen something so steady before. Her character was changing. My mom was always on edge. She was always doing something, always moving, always having to control. She was always on edge, and suddenly I started to see, not all at once, but slowly, this was taking hold, peace. Peace. My mom never had peace before. I want to tell you, if you let Jesus be seen in you, there's somebody right now in your life who desperately needs to see Jesus. And I'm saying, yes, you have to communicate the gospel by speaking the truth about it. Yes, invite them to worship. But one of the most powerful things we can do is become more like Jesus, that Jesus is seen in us, because that's what really drew me. I was like, I don't even understand everything you're saying, Mom, but I see what's happening. I want that. I want him. That's a different prize than I'd been shooting for. But that's the prize that lasts forever. Can he do that in me and in you? Absolutely. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for doing a work in every person who turns in trust in you, that you come into our lives and you begin to change us. And Father, where we have resisted that, we confess, we repent. But God, we can join in this work only in the assurance that we are fully yours now, that now we are already children of God, that now there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. No fear, God. Not a spirit of fear. Oh, but God, the spirit of love and joy and peace, because your Son lives in us. So, God, we're gonna feel sore when we start to work these love muscles out. But God, do that work in us. I pray for those that right now are discouraged, that they can't fit something else in. But God, whatever's happening in their life right now, that you would make that their spiritual discipline, an invitation from you. And give us eyes to see what that is, and then a heart to follow you with all that we have, because you are the prize, to see you, to know you, to love you. So God, we're yours. Here we are again today. But we thank you for your word. We thank you for your presence with us. And we pray you'll continue to work even now as we sing and we worship you in Jesus' name. Amen. So we got this closing song. If you want to pray, we're right here at the doors. Just come out and we would love to pray with you. Let's stand. Let's worship God today.
To know and follow heart.
do it. Thanks for coming.
Times drawing near, but he will love.